In this video, you'll learn how to move, rotate, and scale any object, as well as how to use the modifier stacker. And if you stick right to the end of the video, you'll learn how to turn your donut into a little breakdancer doing the worm. Yeah, it's just a stupid thing. Something fun to end on, anyway. All right, so in the last video, we didn't actually, we didn't make anything. We just moved around and stuff like that. We set a monkey head on fire, but that, again, that was something stupid. Now we're actually gonna start to assemble the scene, which is a donut sitting on a table. So I mentioned this briefly at the end of the last video as the final thing, but to delete in Blender, you do that by hitting the X key, or you can actually just push the delete key, but X or delete. So I'm gonna start by placing the table. So, and I mentioned this in the last video as well, Shift A is how you add any object into Blender. So you can see all the different options here. Yeah, as I mentioned, it's usually always a mesh. That's usually what you always need. And these objects here, you pick the one which most resembles what it is that you're trying to create. So if you were making like a cup, you would generally pick a cylinder. If you were making a house, you might pick a cube. But in our case, we're just going to start with the table. So let's go and add in the plane, okay? So a plane is a completely flat, like one, like double-sided mesh. Like it's just one piece of... it's a plane, right? So I wanna scale this up so that it fits the size of our grid floor here. So you do that in Blender by hitting the S key. And you'll notice that it immediately starts following the mouse. So a lot of other software like Photoshop and well, most programs, like you activate the tool and then you use the mouse to, you know, to then use the tool. Like you click the tool and then you start using it. But Blender's a little different in that from the moment that you push the key, it's already using the tool and it will automatically start following your mouse. So even if your mouse is like in a nowhere near the object that you're using, if you push S, you'll see that it's activating it straight away. So at first it's a little weird. It's like, oh, what? Why is it moving it even though my mouse is over here? But it's actually a really fast way of working because you don't have to worry about where your mouse is in relation to the object, you can just, you know, drag it. Anyway, so we're scaling it. Yay, good for us. Now, if you hold down control during any movement, it'll move it in increments like this. And if you hold down shift, it will move it in like really subtle, slight movements. So yeah, but anyway, we're gonna hold down control just so that it gets to that little grid floor there. Just. It's not really that important, but I just like to keep it nice and tidy, so I keep it on the grid floor. All right, so we've got a plane here. Now let's go ahead and add in our donut. So I'm gonna hit Shift A again, and which of these objects most resembles a donut? Why, it's the torus. Torus. I think torus is one of the objects that I use the least in Blender. It's like one of those things where it's like, when do you ever need an object that looks like this? it just so happens that a donut is. So yeah, it's in the beginner tutorial, but it's a rare object. Anyway, now some objects, when you add them into Blender, you immediately, on the left-hand side, you get some options related to the object. Now, if you were to do something like, so say you add the object and then, I don't know, maybe you scaled the plane or something like that, you'll notice that those options have disappeared now. So the options for the object that you got when you first added it in here, they can only be edited the moment after you add them. So let's just do that again. So I deleted it with X, Shift A, gonna add another torus. Yeah, so you can see that the options here, like if I wanted to change the segments, like how high resolution I want my donut to be. By the way, don't, like I remember when I started Blender, I'm like, everything's gonna be high res. And I made everything this ridiculous high poly mesh, which is not what you wanna do. So you wanna use as few vertices actually as possible. But anyway, so let's say we wanted to adjust the segments here or whatever. You would do this the moment after you add the object. And I think this is pretty much the same for other software as well. Because the moment, you know, after you add something, you can, you know, you should be able to change it. But if you start editing things, well, then you shouldn't really be able to change the object. Otherwise, you might overwrite an edit. Anyway, I'm getting too advanced here. But anyways, just remember that when you add an object, you can change stuff. Now, the one I really want to change is down here where it says minor radius for our torus. So if I turn that up, you can see that I'm just tweaking the minor radius of the torus there. Which, by the way, like these options here are specific to the torus. Like, again, torus is a very rare object, but we are, we're tweaking it to make it look fatter, like a real donut that goes in that little deep fryer thing and, swells up. Anyway, now you'll notice that it is sticking through the floor. So if you haven't done it already, have a go at clicking one of these arrows. So these arrows are on any object that you select, like this one here. It's called a 3D widget tool, and it allows you to move it on a specific axis. So you can see if I hit that green one, it's only moving on the green axis. Red one will only move on the red. The blue one will only move on the blue. Now, these axes are the three dimensions which we live in the world. And you'll find this little tool here, this little thing, will appear in every 3D software you use because there are three axes. So this top axis here, this blue one, it's called the Z axis, and it represents vertical movement up and down. This green one represents the Y axis, which represents side to side. And then, of course, the red one is the X, which represents the depth, like backwards and forwards. Now, the reason I'm telling you this is that so you can move an object by hitting these little arrows here, but you can also move it by hitting the G key. And just like before, it's now moving to your mouse. You don't have to click or anything. And then when you want to stop it, you just click and it's there again. But as well as that, so while you're moving it on G, you can also, after you've pressed G, if you type the letter of any of those axes, like say X, it will now snap it and only move to its X axis. Or I can tap Y, it'll move to its Y, or Z, and it'll move to the Z axis. But if you don't even want to have to remember those axes, there's even a quicker way of doing it. And that is to, whilst you're moving it, if you push the middle mouse key, the middle mouse button there, if you hold it down, I should say, really, and then you point it in the direction of the axes that you want it to go. Like you can see, I'm now pointing it towards the X one, it's moving there. This one is moving it towards the Y, so it's moving it there. So you don't even have to remember the names of them. You can just push the middle mouse key and it'll start moving it to that axis. So what this means is, like, this is how most artists work. We just go like, all right, I'm gonna move it over there, move it down over there. Like, it's very quick. Because if you don't use any axes, you're stuck with wherever it is in that space, like in the distance to the camera, if this makes sense. Like, I can only really move it, in that part of the scene. If I want to bring it closer, if I didn't know the axes, I would have to go like, oh, okay, top view, like bring it all the way down, which you can do, but it's much quicker to be able to just stay oriented where you are and just go like, right. Like, if I want to put it like right over there, I can just go like, like very easy. If I want to put it like directly above the corner of that, So it's a really easy, simple way of working. So it's one of those things that's why like Blender's keyboard shortcuts, they're a little hard to get at first. And you're like, oh, this is kind of, there's a lot of shortcuts going on here. You've got to remember the middle mouse button all the time or whatever, but it's a pretty fast way of working when you get the hang of it. So yeah. Okay. So we've discussed scaling with S and we discussed moving with G. The other one, even though we don't really need it right now because the donut is flat on the table, is rotate, which is R. And so you're rotating it like that. Now, just like before I mentioned with the axes when you're moving, those axes work just the same for scaling as well as rotating. So for example, if I'm rotating and I want to rotate it on just the X axis, if I hit X now, it's now rotating it just on the X axis. And so you can see, let's do scaling as well. So I want to scale it. So I'm making it bigger like that. But if I hit X, I'm scaling it just on that axis. Z, now you can see it's becoming like a cup, So these are very, very common actions. So it's very common, like, you add in a plane like this and like, okay, I want it to be a road. So I'll just scale it along the x-axis, and now it's a road. And by the way, if you ever forget these key presses, well, for one, I got the keyboard shortcut PDF, which you can download by clicking here. Go to my website, and you can download that. But if you do ever forget it, you can use the 3D widget tool, which is, so this thing here, whoops, okay, that was the plane there. So this thing here, like these are just for moving. But if you, down here, if you change it from that to any of these, this one now becomes rotate. So the 3D widget tool has changed to rotate, and then this one will change it to scale. So, you know, I personally do not ever really use the 3D widget tool. So I usually just keep it off because I like to just keep it out of the way. Because once you know the shortcuts, you don't really ever need that often. So I just like to just do everything via shortcuts. And I think most Blender users are the same. But yeah, it's there because I think a lot of people from other software like to use it because they're more familiar with it or something. That's what I've heard down the old grapevine. Let me get a drink here. So, great. We've almost come to the end of this tutorial. Well, there is one final thing I want to mention though, and that is the modifier stack. So if you go over here to the properties panel and then click this little wrench, is that a wrench? Wrench? I know none of the names of tools. It's called the modifier panel. So if you click this, you can see it's completely blank. But if you click this button at the top here, it'll bring this drop down, which you can use to add a whole bunch of different modifiers. So modifiers allows you to modify the current object by choosing any of these options here. And the good thing about this modifier stack is that it doesn't destruct the mesh, okay? So for example, this you can see looks pretty blocky, and you're probably thinking like, come on, when are we gonna make it look smooth? Well, you could do that by using the very, very common modifier called the subdivision surface modifier. So if you click this, you'll notice it becomes smoother. And if I increase this level here, like that, you can see that it becomes smoother and smoother. So, and the good thing is that you can go back again. So that this is what I mean by non-destructive. So because it's a modifier which is like added on top of the object, you have full control over it later on. And don't follow this, but I'm just doing this just so that, to prove a point. So say that I made a torus here and I made it super high res from the get-go, right? Now, if I later on decided that this is too much, because, and I'll explain this when we get to rendering later on, the higher resolution your model is, the longer your render times will be. Now, this won't make much of a difference really in a scene like this because it's very, very low poly right now. We just got a donut sitting on a table. But when you've got a scene with like thousands of objects, when you're making a forest or a desert or anything with lots and lots of objects, you really need to keep an eye on the amount of information in your mesh. So if you were to start with this super high poly mesh and then later on you go, oh no, I need to make it a lot smaller, you have no control over that because it's now, and we'll discuss this in the next video, but I'll just show you now. This is edit mode, and it shows you all the little vertices here. You can't change this. This is now part of the mesh. So modifiers are very cool because they allow you to change the mesh and have full control over it. So I can go, I can make this high resolution, I can tone it back, and then later on I can just go, I don't even need it anymore, and I can just delete it. So to explain, so the subsurface modifier is probably the most common modifier that's ever used. In fact, if you have seen any animated movie ever, probably 99% of all the objects in the movie are they have a subsurf modifier applied to it. Because what it does is it takes a low poly mesh and then it adds extra geometries between them and it smooths it out. So you can see that this was our basic geometry here. And on the top of this donut here, you can see that little sharp edge there. But if I increase it to one level, it's now there's like two extra ones beside it, and it's now smoothed out that curve. And then as you go higher and higher, it's now smoothing out and adding more and more and more geometry, so it becomes smoother and smoother looking. So yeah. Yeah, so that is the subsurf modifier. So we'll use a few more modifiers in the future, but this is a really, really common one, so I did want to start with this. And I did mention at the start of the video I'd show you how to make your donut do the worm. So let's do that right now. So there is a modifier here, and it's called wave. So if you use wave, it really only really makes sense for like a flat plane, because it can kind of make it do this wavy effect. Sometimes if you want to like simulate a flag thing, it can do that. But in this case, it doesn't really make too much sense. But you can see now I've set it to the only one specific axis, the X axis. By the way, I didn't even mention it. To play an animation, if you push any of these buttons down here in the timeline, that'll play the animation. But the keyboard shortcut that just everybody uses is Alt-A. So that was the one that I used there. Anyway, that's a completely pointless thing, but I thought it was a little funny thing that, because I know learning a new software can be pretty boring, so I thought I'd end on something a little funny there. Anyways, go ahead now and click here to watch the next video. Oh, and if you like this video, please give me a like. It really helps me to... so that I can make these sorts of tutorials again in the future. And if you enjoy it, go ahead and hit subscribe. But otherwise, go ahead and click that button so you can watch the next video.